You're watching One India News. This is our weekly show, Global Chit Chat, where we discuss the main developments in the geopolitics this week with our guest and expert, Mr. Tridivesh Singh Maini. Hello, sir. Welcome back to our show.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Sir, so let's just dive right into what's happening right now. As you know that Vladimir Putin has announced a military operation in Ukraine, despite all the warnings from the West. Also, reports of multiple explosions have emerged from Ukraine. And do you think that Russia has enough power to continue with this invasion? The invasion has so-called started in Ukraine. Do you think that the country has the power to continue with this invasion despite being against all the Western countries, especially most of the world?
Yes. So I think, first of all, you very rightly pointed out that, you know, obviously, we know the ramifications. We know that there have been casualties and there have been explosions and things, that, you know. Now, once Putin had taken the decision to recognize the eastern parts as independent territory, obviously, this was on the cards. Because earlier, even this was not expected. Earlier things, you know, till a few days ago, there was talk about the Minsk agreement and everything like that. Now, obviously, once Putin has taken such a risk, in spite of so many warnings, you know, from the West, as far as sanctions are concerned, I think now it's basically, there are two things. One is, as we have sensed, he has, you know, in the global order, obviously, the waning US clout. And secondly, also, he also probably wants to send out even message to China that, you know, it's not going to be a bipolar world. Russia also wants to find its own space. And Russia wants to have its own sphere of influence. So one is obviously, you know, what are the immediate ramifications, the casualties and things. We also need to understand the larger global impact. So if you look at it, if you look at Europe, US and the West and the warnings which they've issued to Russia with regard to sanctions and things, I mean, obviously, there will be severe ramifications in Russia. But what Putin has calculated is that, you know, in terms of messaging and in terms of sending out the fact that, yes, you know, that Russia also wants to revive its earlier role on the global stage, you know. So I think these are things which we need to bear in mind. And also, you see, China is also in a bind because on the one hand, obviously, if you like a couple of weeks ago, we had discussed a joint statement which had been issued by Russia and China. So China had supported Russia in that. It had spoken against NATO. But then on the other hand, if you look at one, obviously, the impact on the global economy. And two, if you look at the possibility of, you know, the Russian actions impacting China's economic relations with the European Union and other Western countries, obviously there is a problem there. There's a serious problem over there. So now what we need, what really needs to be seen is obviously Putin at this point of time believes that the West does not have enough leverage. So if he has to stop, it will be some other. So will China, for instance, put some pressure? Will the West use China to pressurize Putin? That is what we need to see. And also, the other thing which you need to see is that this, you know, the already, if you look at global oil prices, they have crossed $100. If you look at the price of crude, I think it's touching 104 today. Yesterday, it crossed 100. So now this is going to have serious, I mean, this is going to impact everyone, you know, because of, and as it is also, there were this talk about the revival of the Iran nuclear deal. That had, there was, you know, that was also going to have an impact on oil prices somehow or the other. Now, this, but this is a series, this decision of Russia to actually go whole hog, it'll impact oil. Then obviously it leads to inflation. So it has, it, I mean, the global ramifications are serious. And even China cannot ignore that. You see, earlier, like we've been discussing, that China, certain changes within its own domestic economy and all, it had, in a controlled way, it was seeking to bring about corrections. But now, in the last few months, it has realized that there's such a slowdown there that it cannot deal with the problems. Now, any further global economic challenges also mean that China gets hit. And now, you know, you're barely getting out of Omicron and all that. So this is a major disruption. And this is really important in the context of the global geopolitical architecture. I mean, see, 2014 also was an important decision. But 2014, the US decline was not, I mean, it obviously there was a win, the influence was waning, but now the image which this sends out, if you look at the last year, if you look, for instance, at the first, the withdrawal from Afghanistan, the reaction of allies to that, then so many other geopolitical challenges. And even though it's not easy to deal with these problems, the perception is that the US is weak, right? So obviously, and this will build up even further. And even now, once Putin has done whatever he had to, you can impose sanctions, you can do, but his messaging has gone across. So I think what we really need to see is whether we are in, again, you know, for a world order, which is not, so earlier it was very simplistically, it was like US versus China and Russia. So is it going to be US, China and Russia, right? And then there will be certain countries which can, you know, a country like Iran, for instance, it can leverage even between China and Russia. So the geopolitical order is, you know, in for some very uncertain times. And the global architecture is becoming quite complex.
Correct. Also, sir, so like you said that this invasion is going to impact a lot of countries globally. It's going to have a proper global impact, right? So if Russia continues with this invasion, and what do you think it means for India in terms of foreign diplomacy, in terms of imports, or in terms of alliances? What do you think it means for India?
So the first question is your economic dependence upon Russia,
right?
Your historical relations, even though there has been a slight, you know, because of India getting closer to the US, obviously your relationship with Russia has got impacted. And what you've also seen is Pakistan is, so for instance, the Pakistan PM happens to be in Russia at this point of time.
Yeah.
So that again, you know, earlier during the Cold War, Pakistan was with the US and you were closer to Russia, right? And in fact, there was at one point of time, it was Pakistan, China and US in one camp. Right. So even if you look at it in the context of South Asia, it was very odd. I mean, at that point of time during the Cold War, for different reasons, China was with Pakistan and the US obviously supported Pakistan because they felt that India is closer to Russia. Now that has changed. But will India now, it's very tough to make choices. But then there is this question that, you know, on the one hand, if you're part of this whole, for instance, you attended the Summit of Democracies, and can you support this action? Can you, and then when you, if you talk about sovereignty, now see, that's a problem, that's a dilemma even for China, that on the one hand it has to support Russia, but on the other, when it talks about sovereignty, how can it, you know, defend this action? So every country is facing a dilemma. But I think for India, the major dilemma is that on the one hand, economy, your various your relations of the past, your defense relations like the S-400 and so on and so forth. And on the other hand, you are growing closer to the US. You're part of this whole anti-China, not blatantly anti-China, but this group which is trying to counter China. So if you look at the economic ration, it's very tough to take a call. But I think geopolitically, a lot of analysts have been arguing that India should actually pitch themselves in the US camp. The problem with that is, In the last few years, that has resulted in, I think what has happened is that the US does support you, but to a point, but your relationship with Russia has deteriorated further. But then this is a different situation altogether. You can't really afford to, I don't think there is any balancing act would be possible, but it's quite tough, I think, dilemma.
Right. And speaking about Pakistan, PM being in Russia, so we know that, you know, after 4 months since India proposed Pakistan about the sending of wheat to Afghanistan, they finally allowed one truck, I think carrying around 2,500 tons of wheat from Food Corporation of India to reach Afghanistan. I think it hasn't reached yet, it's on its way, right? So why do you think that it took so long for them to allow this first consignment to reach Afghanistan? Or why do you think they have allowed it right now?
I think, like we've discussed in previous weeks, there are some back channels going on, and probably, you know, they also, you know, as you've spoken about, like messaging and posturing. So, but I think in principle, this was agreed to a few weeks back. I think the logistics were also being worked out. Now, the question is that, you know, you have a back channel going on. A senior official in Imran Khan's government also recently said that, you know, it's time to, you know, resume bilateral trade. Now, the question is, that are you going to, is this also going to lead to opening up a bilateral trade? That's a bigger question. because so many, so for instance, like we discussed earlier, I think one very good thing which happened was at least, you know, the opening up of the Kartarpur corridor again after 2 years, 1.5 years in November 2021. As we said, you know, there have been a lot of meetings, like so families have got reunited. So that has generated goodwill. Now, in Punjab, which is actually just, you know, the assembly, like the votes were cast on the 20th, there is now an appetite, especially in the border belt, for the resumption of bilateral ties. And traders, businessmen in Amritsar, especially that belt, they have been, you know, saying that the next logical step should be, because actually in 2012, India had set up an integrated check post at Atari with the aim of, you know, giving a push to bilateral trade. And between 2012 and 14, there was an incremental rise. Number of steps were taken at that point of time. Now you need that again, because what has happened is that, you know, the level of bilateral trade through the Wagah Atari land crossing, it doesn't, okay, it's not, in, if you look at it, maybe it's between $2 and $3 billion. Right. But what it does is it gives a push to the tertiary sector of that belt. So whether it's transport, whether it's in then hotels and things like that. So they have got a boost in recent years. So what happens is, like, if you have bilateral trade, a lot of goods are naturally not going from only from Punjab itself, from outside. So traders will use that, you know, Wagah Atari belt. And then for trade, for businessmen from North India, it's much easier, obviously, to do it through this land crossing, rather than, you know, because trade is already going on through Dubai and Singapore. I mean, there are unofficial estimates that trade is up to $8-9 billion through third destinations. So why not do it through this land crossing, which will give a significant boost to the economy of the state. And in fact, the manifestos of some political parties also, they have spoken about in previous elections also, and even this time, there was a reference about, you know, the at least Wagah Atari, open, you know, resumption of trade and some more land crossings. So this, that should be the logical step forward. And I think there is some appetite. Business communities have been for this for very long. I mean, you know, after the disruption of trade in 2019, they have been saying that it is time to resume trade and all that. But then there are other factors.
Right. So lastly, we come to the Middle East, where the Iranian president's visit is slated on February 21st and 22nd. So what can you say, talk about that the visit and why, and can you just elaborate on the visit?
Yes. So he was, the Iranian president was actually invited for the, you know, there was something, there's the Gas Exporting Countries Forum, GECF. So he, the visit was from February 21st to 22nd. The invitation had been handed over to the Iranian president during the visit of the Qatari foreign minister to Iran in January 22. Now, apart from addressing the GECF, so first, if you look at what was during his address in the GECF, first, the Iranian president spoke against Western sanctions. So, and but what was also interesting was that he said that Iran, in case, you know, there's a crisis, Iran is also willing to supply oil and natural gas to Europe. So this is very interesting. This is one in terms, obviously, given the current crisis, that's important, and also in how Iran wants to sort of, you know, balance its foreign policy. Doesn't want to appear, may have problems with the US, but does not want to be anti-West as a whole. Then obviously, criticize sanctions, supported Russia. So that is one part of it. But at a bilateral level, there were 14 MOUs, and predictably, you know, the focus was on things like energy, on infrastructure, and also, what was interesting was that the Iranian president spoke about setting up an Iranian trade center in Doha, so that, you know, Qatari businessmen are made aware of the opportunities, business opportunities in Iran. Now, that said, again, you know, this is these are all so MOUs and all, that's all work in progress. But I think what is significant is that it was his first visit to a Gulf country and only his fourth international visit. Right. And the first visit by an Iranian president in 11 years to Qatar. Okay. This is important. And the other factor is also, I mean, if you look at the Qatar is one country within the GCC which has consistently kept good relations with Iran. And that is when 2017, a diplomatic blockade had been imposed upon Qatar by four, you know, Arab countries. And in 2021, that was removed. that the Trump administration had played a back important role in the back channel for, you know, resumption of diplomatic ties. But one of the reasons for this diplomatic blockade was that Qatar had close, you know, relations with Iran, apart from support for certain Islamist groups, but its close proximity with Iran was cited as one of the reasons. So today, it's very interesting that, you know, at that point of time, the US was also critical of Qatar for its relations with Iran. So that's why 2017, when the blockade was imposed, the US essentially didn't really criticize it. So later on, they said that, you know, kind of. But now, Qatar's foreign policy, which is, you know, where it has managed to have good relations with the US. So during his visit, I mean, during the visit of the Emir of Qatar to the US, Qatar was declared as a non-NATO ally, as you know, for the role in the negotiations between the Taliban and the US for the evacuation of US citizens from Afghanistan, even as the role of, and most importantly also as an intermediary in the Iran nuclear deal, you know, both sides, because it has good relations. So I think it's an important message that, you know, you can, this whole thing about, yeah, sometimes you have to make choices, but even a balanced foreign policy. And I think what has really helped Qatar is that it did not totally toe the US line as far as Iran is concerned. And ironically, that is an asset that has proven to be useful for the US itself. So I think, and Iran, it's, even if you look at Iran now, there are attempts by Iran to send out a message that it does not want to have a very skewed foreign policy. See, as far as the nuclear deal is concerned or ties with the US are concerned, it doesn't have any options. Because if you look at the US itself, there are a lot of domestic lobbies which are opposed to, you know, calming down the tensions. But vis-a-vis Europe, vis-a-vis the West, vis-a-vis a number of other US allies. So I think Iran could actually learn, you know, from Qatar. And in fact, the other interesting part is, as a result of its increasing relevance, Qatar has also managed now to upstage, you know, Saudi Arabia. Earlier, when you looked at the GCC, even the Middle East as a whole. And part of this, I mean, in the midst of Biden's numerous, you know, foreign policy challenges and many would say failures also, I think one success has been that he has not, unlike Trump, he has not allowed Saudi Arabia and Israel to dictate his foreign policy choices within the Middle East. And, you know, given greater importance. So reaching out to Qatar and using them as an important sort of stakeholder was, I think, a significant move in that sense. So the Middle East, and now what is happening in between Russia and Ukraine, even there, Qatar is an important player because the US has said that, you know, Qatar could supply, oil. Though Qatar has said that unilaterally it cannot do so because there are agreements in place. And even otherwise, you know, it's not in a position to unilaterally do so, it has to do with other countries. But if it does have a role, I think that will further elevate, you know, its stature globally in that sense. I think what has benefited it, apart from the foreign policy part about balancing, is also its increasing emphasis, you know, on a soft power, on building, unlike other countries in the GCC, it is trying to build some sort of knowledge economy, you know, media. So that is also, and at times it differs, you know, obviously the lot of Western media organizations, they have problems with the narrative emanating from there, but at least you have an independent narrative and that really helps it. I think that a lot of other countries which only, which are trying to move away from the dependence upon oil can learn from this aspect of building this sort of, you know, one thing is all obviously your economy, your infrastructure and all, but also intellectual capital, having a solid knowledge base, having media. I think these are the lessons which can be learned.
So thank you so much, sir, for that information. Join us again on Global Chit Chat next week. Thank you so much for watching One India News.